Job 31:1 KJV. I made a covenant with mine eyes. Why then should I think upon a maid? Most of the time, we think sexual immoralities start from the heart. We feel we think about it, and then we act according to it. Sexual immorality doesn't start from the heart. The heart is just the second stage of sexual immorality. Job knew about these stages of sexual immorality. He knew that it will always start from what he looks at. If he looks lustfully at a woman, the heart will start to think about that, and then it will push Job into sin. Job made a covenant with his eyes never to look lustfully at women. David couldn't make that kind of covenant with his eyes, and he fell into sin. There are many warnings about sexual immoralities that have been given in the Bible, but it is something that is becoming hard for many people to avoid, and I can tell you that Christians are included. Look at one of the warnings regarding sexual immorality in the Bible. Proverbs 6:32. But whoso committeth adultery with a woman lacketh understanding. He that doeth it destroyeth his own soul. You see, this is proof that not all sin is the same. Yes, ultimately all sin brings death, but they are not the same. You can't tell a lie and sin against your own body. You can't tell a lie and destroy your soul. But the Bible did not say a thief destroyeth his own soul, or a liar destroyeth his own soul, but an adulterer destroyeth his own soul. There is something serious about sexual immorality that I believe that we as humans don't fully comprehend. Proverbs 9:16 through 17. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. And for him who lacks understanding, she says to him, stolen water is sweet, and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. Here this lady is quoting a well-known saying which is a half-truth, and we all know that a half-truth is a lie. In other words, what she is saying is, illicit sex of an adulterer or fornicator is more satisfying than sex between a husband and wife, which God has sanctioned. Hence the saying, stolen water is sweet, and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. And in all honesty, she is telling the truth, but she is not telling the whole truth, because she does not tell you the end of the story. Let's be honest, there is pleasure in sin. People don't commit sin because it hurts them. No, people commit sin because there is pleasure in sin. There is an enjoyment in sin for a period of time. And that pleasure in sin is what she is talking about. There is some genuine allure in the excitement, independence, camaraderie, and pleasure in breaking God's command and wisdom's counsel. Sin has its pleasures for a season. Now, verse 18, Solomon then tells the readers the part that she is conveniently missed out. Proverbs 9:16 through 18. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. And as for him who lacks understanding, she says to him, stolen water is sweet, and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. Verse 18. But he does not know that the dead are there, that her guests are in the depths of hell. I remember the first time I read this verse, I literally stopped for 30 minutes and spoke to my father about this verse. Listen to it one more time. He does not know that the dead are there, that her guests are in the depths of hell. Sexual immorality is something that we should not play with. A major area of sexual immorality that is in the church today is pornography. This is a serious issue in Christianity today. This is something we need to address in the church today. You will see many people. They don't look at the opposite sex lustfully, but they watch porn at the corner of their house. Some people will preach against looking at the opposite sex lustfully, but they cannot stop watching porn in the corner of their house. The problem that porn brings is not just addiction and sexual immorality. It is far beyond that. It affects one psychologically. I was going through the statistics of people who watch porn, and I can tell you that it is scary. About 40 million American people watch it regularly. It is also known that 35% of all the internet downloads are related to pornography. In church, 1 out of 5 youth pastors watch it regularly, and 1 out of 7 adult pastors watch it regularly. Upwards of 70% of Christians or church members are still struggling with it today, and they watch at least once a month. 90% of teens and 96% of young adults are either encouraging, accepting, or staying neutral on the discussion of this topic. I'm not judging anyone. I'm not judging people struggling to get out of this addiction, but this is not something you should accept as part of your life. If Job says he has made a covenant with his eyes not to look lustfully on women, why should you not make the same covenant not to watch porn? Many people don't even know how to relate with other people anymore because of this addiction. Many people are facing depression because they hate themselves for this. So what happens in the unseen world when you watch pornography and it becomes an addiction? The plain and simple truth is that it becomes a stronghold. And once Satan has a stronghold in your life, he will not let go of it easily. This is why people want to stop, but they can't. 10, 20, 30 years battling with this same sin. Why? Because it is a stronghold. 1, 2, 3 clicks, and you have access to another world. And the more you are there in this world, the deeper this stronghold gets, and the more its claws wrap around you. I remember a young man that went to my church and asked for prayer. He came to me saying, Pastor, I need prayer. And I asked him, what for? He said every time he would try to pray, the images of these unholy things he was watching on the internet would pop up in his head. Anytime he would pray, he would begin to start seeing these things in his mind, and he would stop. It was as if there was a literal wall between him and God. It even affected his relationship with God. This young man came to me in tears. He wanted to stop, but he couldn't. And there are so many people who are in the same situation. As soon as the young man said this to me, I thought of Isaiah 59, 1 through 2. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened, that it cannot save, neither his ear heavy, that it cannot hear. But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you, that he will not hear. The problem with this stronghold is that it introduces other strongholds. Once pornography becomes a stronghold, lust becomes a stronghold, and that leads you to another stronghold. Fornication. Fornication then graduates when you are married to adultery. One stronghold opens up the door to more. What happens to the unseen world when you watch pornography is that it builds lust. It builds it. It feeds it. It gives nutrition to lust. It gives lust everything it needs to grow.
When lust burns in the hearts of people, it causes them to behave foolishly and irrationally. The worst is that people will keep suffering for the irrational actions they commit through the lust of their hearts. Yet, they will not desist from such actions. Allow this sermon to be a warning against lust. The truth is, lust is something you have to fight at every stage of life. Even if you are 16, you have to fight lust. If you are 60, you have to fight it. If you are single and you think lust will go away when you are married, that is a lie. You have to fight lust at every stage of your life. I believe one of the greatest causes for our regrets as humans is lust. If you want a better future for yourself, you have to deal with lust. Lust will cloud your judgment. Lust will destroy you. Lust will break your home up. Lust will destroy your health. Lust will take your money away. Lust will rob you of your joy. Lust will put a wall between you and God. Lust will throw you into a hole deeper than you ever thought you could go. Lust, unchecked, will leave you in a place where you will wonder, how did I get here? I say all this because I have seen it firsthand with my own eyes. I have seen lust cause two people who had no intention of being with one another have to bring up a child together because of lust. I have seen people stay in relationships that were not leading to marriage because of lust. Let's be honest. Lust will make you contact people you have no business contacting. Lust clouds your mind and judgment. Your ability to make good decisions goes out the window when lust is involved. When you have sex on your mind, your reasoning skills and your decision making is poor. Lust makes you irresponsible. It is like a drug. When people are high on drugs, they are not as responsible as they would be with a sober mind. Lust will make a man to forfeit and destroy a 20-year marriage for 10 minutes of pleasure. Isn't it really foolish for a man who has built a 20-year marriage to forfeit his wife and children and begin to pursue a girl for 10 minutes of pleasure? What is the wisdom behind a man leaving his wife behind to pursue another man's wife? Lust blindfolds a man and robs him of his wisdom and strength. And one of the biggest lies you will hear is that lust is a male-only problem. No, it is not. Women struggle with it just as much as men. There are some things people do that they try to hold the devil responsible for. Meanwhile, it is their lust that caused them to act that way.
Why do you think Job made a covenant with his eyes? The idea of the covenant, the term covenant is of Latin origin, convenire, meaning a coming together. It presupposes two or more parties who come together to make a contract, agreeing on promises, stipulations, privileges, and responsibilities. He was in agreement with his eyes to know what he will look at. Job 31:1. I made a covenant with mine eyes. Why then should I think upon a maid? Lust is not something to be played with. 2 Samuel 11:1 through 2. And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab, and his servants with him, and all Israel. And they destroyed the children of Ammon, and besieged Rabbah. But David tarried still at Jerusalem. And it came to pass, in an eveningtide, that David arose from off his bed, and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. Him seeing this woman led to all of David's issues. The eyes look and see, then the heart will store it up, and the brain will start processing it, giving you to think of it all the time. When you commit sexual sin, you are not sinning against other people. You are not sinning outside of your body. You are not sinning to destroy other people's lives, but you are sinning against your body. You are destroying your own life. 1 Corinthians 6:18 KJV. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. Run from sexual sins and every form of sexual sin. Run from the sources of sexual sin.